We thank Vice President Ostros for sharing the opening remarks on behalf of the EIB. Mr. Ostros highlighted the significant capacity building initiatives that the EIB is championing across Africa through sponsoring regional financial academies, supporting events such as this forum, and advancing significant credit resources. Mr. Ostros also profiled the unique and significant role being played by multilateral development banks, MDBs, like the EIB, worldwide, to address climate change and to help countries make the most of the new opportunities that the current winds of change bring. He mentioned various EIB interventions, including direct financing, the Women Empowerment SHE Investment Program, blended financing, and lines of credit to commercial banks like Cooperative Bank of Kenya and microfinance institutions. Thanks again, Mr. Ostros, for enlightening us on these matters, which are at the heart of this year's forum. Now it is time to roll up our sleeves and get into the main agenda. Our first speaker today is Dr. Evans Osano, Director for Capital Markets at FSD Africa. Dr. Osano leads a team of bright and energetic young minds at FSD Africa who are focused on developing the markets for stocks, shares, bonds, currencies, and other financial assets across the region with a view to addressing social and developmental challenges. It therefore gives me great pleasure to invite Dr. Evans Osano to take the floor.
Good morning. Yeah, it is an honor to be here this morning to talk about the state of capital markets development in Africa and the perspectives of green bonds. I will focus my presentation largely on the green finance opportunities that we see in the continent. And I'll be talking about basically four different things. The first one is just to give you the mega trends, because it's very important to put the perspective of this work around the mega trends that we see in the continent. Very, very, very briefly, I'll touch on the state of the markets. And then I'll spend a lot of the time discussing about green finance opportunities, looking at the business case, the development case, also understanding the opportunities that we have in the continent, plus, of course, instruments like green bonds, the taxonomy, and some of the work that we have done at FSD Africa. But ladies and gentlemen, allow me to start the presentation with a quote from our brothers and sisters in Mozambique. They say that a river that cannot be controlled is bound to burst its banks. Climate change is like a river. If we don't control it, it's likely to burst its banks. And I think the consequences of that is what you'd like to see in the picture there. And this morning as I was coming, I was reminded of who our clients are, who are our stakeholders. And because they were not able to come here to be with us in person, they have sent me with a message, and I like my colleagues there to play a video so that we can get the message from our stakeholders.
I am an African child, born with a skin the color of chocolate, bright, brilliant, and articulate, strong and bold. I am gifted, talented enough to be the best. I am an African child.
Often the target of pity. My future is not confined to charity. Give me a gift of a lifetime. Give me a dream, a door of opportunity. I will thrive. I am an African child.
Do not hide my fault. Show me my wrong. I am like any other. Teach me to dream, and I will become. I am an African child.
I am the sun, daughter of the soil, rich in texture and content, full of potential for a better tomorrow. Teach me discipline, teach me character, teach me hard work. Teach me to think like the star within me. I am an African child.
I can be extraordinary. Call me William Kamkwamba, the inventor. Give me a library with books. Give me a scrapyard and discarded electronics. Give me a broken bicycle, plus the freedom to be me, and I will build you a windmill. I am an African child.
We are the new generation, not afraid to be us, uniquely gifted, black and talented, shining like the stars we are. We are the children of Africa, making the best of us. Yes, I am an African child.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. That's why we're here this morning. These are our clans. This is the future for the continent. Whatever we do, it's always good to keep this in mind. So let me paint the context a little bit more in terms of Africa. As we know today, the population is about 1.4 billion. By 2050, we expect the population in Africa to be 2.5 billion. 26% of the global population is going to be in this continent. That population is also urbanizing very quickly. Today we are talking about 44%, that is 2020. By 2050, we'll be talking about 60% of Africans living in the urban areas. Just spare a moment and think what that implication is in terms of food security, food systems, and everything, in terms of the amount of infrastructure that we need to provide. It is a very young population, as we've heard from the clip. The average age is 19.7 years. That's the median. And then on top of that, we've heard from the Vice President, we've heard this morning about climate change. It's a major threat for the continent as well. So I'll not talk about the context in Kenya, which is very, very similar to what we have seen in Africa. But I think it's very, very important as we do our work to try and put this kind of context in mind. Touching a little bit on climate change, the World Economic Forum releases what we call the Global Risk Perceptions Survey. This is a survey for 2021, 2022, and as you can see, the top five risks in terms of their likelihood of happening are all related to the environment. And I think that's why we should pay attention to this topic. Yes, we've heard about the dislocations, we've heard about debt crisis, we've heard about all these other things, but you can see over the next 5-10 years, these are going to be the most important risks in terms of facing the world. And on climate, if I touch on it a little bit, the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, released their sixth assessment report in March of this year, and it was worrisome when I read the report. It basically said that Africa is warming up faster than the global average. Sea level rise in Africa has been faster than the global average over the last 3 decades, and it's projected to rise even faster. So we are going to see more severe floods, sea level rise, increased rain and intensity, and this is actually quite interesting. They are not necessarily projecting that rainfall patterns are going, rain is going to go down in terms of precipitation. We are likely to get actually more rainfall. The difference would be that that rain is going to come down much more intensely. So what you get over 3 months will probably come down in 1 month. And that has very serious implication on the flooding and also in terms of the food systems and all that. Now, the other thing that really shocked me when I read that report is that they are saying global warming is rising faster than was initially anticipated. And more so, that the impact of that rise is actually much more severe than has always been thought. So something to get concerned. So climate change has a very big impact on the economy, as many of us know, on the financial sector, and there are a lot of, linkages, you know, things that impact on the economy, the financial sector, and there's a kind of a feedback loop. But there's one more risk that I don't think we've paid enough attention, because when you look at climate change, we look at physical risk, we look at transitional risk. There's now what you call the liability risk, and I don't think we've been paying a lot of attention. I came across this report last night looking at, cases that have been brought, climate-related cases that have been taken to the courts. You can see the trajectory. It's in the US, but the bulk of that is in the US, but you can see non-US. Countries are also rising. So if this is not something that will make us pay attention, I think I don't know what else will. And a lot of these cases actually being brought against not just oil and gas companies, but also against financial sector companies, banks and others, pension funds, insurance companies and all that. Which brings me to the topic of financing. So FSD Africa last year, actually this year, we undertook a study called the Landscape for Climate Finance in Africa, where we are looking at what is the climate finance need in the continent. So we look at the NDCs, the nationally determined contributions of all the countries in the continent. We added up the numbers. That figure came up to about $277 billion annually. That's what is required in Africa to meet the NDCs. Then we also tried to track what is coming through, and the number we came up with was about $30 billion. So it basically means we are getting a drop of what we need to address the climate change issues in the continent. We need to increase that amount of financing by about 9 times. In addition to that, what we also noticed that the private sector is contributing a much smaller percentage of what is required, about 14%. You can compare with what is happening in the other regions. Yet when you look at the NDCs, they estimate that about 90% of the funding that is required is going to come from the private sector and international sources. But today we are talking about 14%. So you can imagine the degree of ambition that we need to have to increase our funding. Now, in addition to that, if I can just give you some absolute numbers, so it's $30 billion that is coming in. Out of the $30 billion, about $4.2 billion is private sector. Of that, about 49% of that, which is about slightly over $2 billion, is coming from domestic sources, and it's just a very small amount that is coming from international sources. In addition to that, there's a lot of concentration. 74% of the investment is going into renewable energy, and as we know, climate change requires multi-sectoral kind of approach. 74% is going into renewable energy. How do we diversify that? Good, so I'll go to the next section where I'll talk about the capital markets and potentially start building up a case on what might be done to support this agenda. First of all, capital markets in Africa are very, very small. As you can see from the chart, the first chart, that is the percentage, you know, the share of the banking assets, the share of government debt markets, the share of the equity markets as a percentage of GDP. Look at Nigeria. Government debt markets are below 9%. Yeah. Equity markets, more or less the same. The banking sector is not big. It's about 29% of GDP. It's a very, very small financial system relative to the size of the economy. Kenya is a bit better, but not necessarily much better. And then, of course, we have seen South Africa seems to be a bit of an outlier there. And I compare that with the Malaysia, just to give you a sense of what maybe an optimal or comparable countries might be looking at. And then when you look at closer to East Africa, on the second chart, the assets that sit within the banking sector, the non-banking financial institutions, including pension funds and insurance, collective investment schemes, is about $82 billion. That is the latest number that I got, and that compares to the market capitalization of the Nairobi Securities Exchange, which is at $16.5 billion. That's equities, and half of that is one company. Government debt market, that $5 billion. So you can see the assets under management are actually much bigger than the financial sector. And that basically, to me, tells me that as we look at climate financing, as we look at ESG financing or investment, we also need to think about looking at private capital markets. The role of private equity, the role of private debt should be part of a complementary solution that we provide. And the opportunities. So look at the right and see the assets under management sitting with pensions, insurance, collective investment schemes in Africa. I didn't put the number there for South Africa because it's very large. So I've looked at, you know, more smaller countries from Morocco, Kenya, Nigeria, Ghana, you can see. So collectively, assets under management within institutional investors in Africa sit at more than $1 trillion. Those assets today are very, very conservatively managed. They are predominantly invested in government securities. In basically Nigeria, 90% of pension investments sit in fixed income securities, with a big percentage of that being in government securities. only less than 10% is actually in the equity market. That picture is not very different from Kenya, from Zambia, from Uganda, and from all these other countries. And then look at what we are seeing in terms of the global pools of capital that might be available, that might be attracted into the continent. The G funds, the number of the membership has actually increased to over 500, and the assets under management collectively is about $135 trillion. $135 trillion. Can you imagine what it could take if you got just 1% of that capital coming into the continent? But how do we make that happen? How do we leverage that? How do we leverage the domestic institutional investor base that we have? A lot of that has to come through demonstration transactions. In addition to that, we have to think about how we de-risk some of the investments. As I said, we have very conservative investment policies and capacity. So de-risking is very important using blended structures and guarantees. We also have to develop vehicles, including green bonds or funds, green ETFs, and I'm very happy that TDB Bank has come up with a green equity. That's innovation. That's the kind of innovation we want to see. And then in addition to that, we need to think how we can address the short-termism. A lot of these investors are very short-term in their mindset, and that can be addressed from a number of ways. And of course, we also need to think about how do we support the appropriate policy regulatory environment that makes it easy to access this capital, that makes it faster to access the capital, that makes it cost-effective to access this capital that sits within our institutional investors. So that takes me to green investing. And I want to start by looking at the developmental case and then the business case. Why is this important? So from a developmental case, as I mentioned, Africa is a developing continent that is urbanizing very quickly. So that basically means we need to build significant infrastructure, housing, water, power, and we can build all this infrastructure in a climate-resilient way. We don't have a legacy of large infrastructure that is bad, that has to be retrofit. We can do this. We can almost build, from the beginning. The transition towards a carbon neutrality and environmental sustainability is going to also reduce the negative impact of climate change, but more so among the poor communities. And I heard that in the morning. And I strongly believe that environmentally friendly growth can also improve access to food, services, it can also create green jobs, and it can also increase incomes of people as well. And in terms of the business case, I think many of us probably bought into this. There are opportunities for first-time movers who can also boost their profitability. There are opportunities for harnessing the natural capital that Africa is very abundant with. And we also should not ignore that Africa is actually part of the global supply chain. So if you don't green and you are supplying certain components or certain raw materials to somebody else sitting in Europe or somewhere else, the conditions, the standards are going to be imposed on you, or you're going to be cut off from the supply chain. So we cannot quite ignore that. And then for financial sector firms and funds, as I demonstrated before, they face major risks if they do not address Africa's green challenges. And as we have heard, environmental risk can also impact operations and directly impact the profitability of companies. This one is quite interesting, and is a study that was done in Kenya. That was in 2014. This was basically the study was on the green economy assessment report. As we know, Kenya is very dependent on natural capital. 42% of Kenya's GDP is from natural capital: agriculture, forestry, fishing, tourism. And we believe that preserving and enhancing the natural capital can ensure that we provide sustainable livelihoods, both for the current generations and also for the generations that spoke to us at the beginning. Low carbon climate resilient growth can also enhance human well-being, including reducing pollution, improving our health outcomes, and reducing congestion. An opportunity that's going to give us an opportunity to live in a much more attractive environment. And in many cases, all these benefits that I've talked about are never captured in the GDP numbers. And just to add one point, according to this report, if Kenya adopted a green growth trajectory, GDP was actually going to rise by about 12% by 2030 compared to a business as usual case. So there's actually an economic rationale as well. I talked about opportunities in the urban sector. Africa, as I said, is quickly urbanizing. By 2050, we're going to have 950 million more Africans living in urban areas. Just imagine that. Those are 950 million houses that we may need to build between now and 2050. But today, about 60% of those people who live in urban areas live in informal settlements. And as we know from science, cities actually magnify the impacts, all the aspects of climate change in terms of flooding, in terms of heat, and even sea level for those cities that are close to the sea. We have done a study about last year, actually looking at opportunities for transiting the cities into what we call clean, compact, connected, resilient cities in the continent. We looked at that 5 cities in South Africa, in Ethiopia and Kenya, and the investment required to do the transformation was about $280 billion. But the economic returns was projected at $1.1 trillion. So there's definitely a very strong business case there, or economic rationale as well. Good. So let me just briefly talk about the instruments that are available for us. We are financial sector industry. So there are a lot of instruments that we can use to be able to raise financing for the green investments or the green transition. In the capital markets, a number of debt instruments, from green bonds, sustainability bonds, and much more recently, we are seeing a lot of interest around sustainability-linked bonds. Equity markets, also there are a number of products that we can use. But I'm actually much more excited also by the opportunities that we have around what we call outcome-based financing. Payment for ecological services, carbon secured debt. There's going to be a lot of innovation coming out from that space. And I think Africa is actually very well positioned to take advantage of increasing financing through innovation around outcome-based financing. Similarly, in the insurance and banking sector, again, a lot of opportunities from green loans and all that that can also be utilized. And let me just demystify a little bit green bonds. Green bonds are basically very similar to the conventional bonds. What you need to add is basically what we call the green credentials. And in many cases, if you're using the ICMA principles, it's around the use of proceeds. Where is the money going? And then you have to go through a process of laboring or certifying and all that just to give assurances to the investors. There's a reporting requirement. There's a requirement or disclosure requirements around how you manage the proceeds, how you report to the investors, how you select the projects and things like that. So they are fairly straightforward. They come with a slightly additional cost, which is around the labeling process. It's not very massive costs from our own experience. So it's not anything very different from what we are used to today. And in terms of the taxonomy that underlies these bonds, you can see it's quite broad. It covers very, very many sectors. You know, I was talking to a CEO of a commercial bank in Zambia, and when I talked about green finance, he told me, are those forests? Is it about trees? And I said, no, it's not about trees. It's much bigger than that. Every single sector can raise financing that is green, depending, of course, on the criteria that you apply. From transport, from energy. Energy is probably the easiest to understand, but transport is also a big one. From water, from buildings. The built environment is a very big contributor to CO2 emissions. Land use, forestry, that comes in there. From industry, from waste management, all the way to ICT as well. So it basically means that there are very many opportunities we have to raise the green financing. And a lot of these investments will be very strongly aligned to SDGs as well. And I believe that given the very nascent nature of African markets, we have a very, very, very strong opportunity to build our markets in a sustainable manner. A number of companies that have been able to come to the market, as we know, including in Kenya, Econ issued a bond not many years ago. A small SME, they could not have been able to get any funding from the market if it was not for a green bond. So we have a great opportunity to build these markets that way. And as you can see, the green bond market has been growing very quickly. It's still a very small percentage of the global green bond, the global bond market. It's about 1.5% of that. As we know, the global bond market is about now about over slightly over $100 trillion. And so the green bond market is just about 2% of that. But it's growing very fast, as you can see. And then in the continent in Africa, you can see where the hotspots have been, where we've had issues. South Africa has obviously has been leading, and then Morocco, Nigeria, and I'm ashamed to say that Benin, the amount of bonds they have issued that are thematic, they are much bigger than the whole region in Eastern Africa, yeah? One country, one small country. So I think this basically speaks to the opportunity that we have here. Good, so I'll go very quickly on this just to talk about some of the work we've been supporting as FSD Africa to support green financing in the continent. On the capital markets, we have a footprint in about 33 countries around the continent. The ones in green are some of our priority countries, but we have more than 60 different initiatives. And those range from regulatory initiatives, and you can see the number of initiatives that we have supported, regulations or laws, to demonstration transactions. So collectively, we have supported issuance of green bonds and gender bonds. Yes, gender bonds in Morocco, in Tanzania, combined about $434 million in local currency. These have been some of the first-time sort of issuers in those markets. That's more or less the geographical footprint. But in terms of the specific transactions, we can see in Morocco, we support the very first gender bond in the continent and the first green mobility bond in Africa. So this was ONCF, the railway company in Morocco that raised about $100 million in a green bond to invest in electric trains. In Nigeria, we supported the first green bond, including the first sovereign green bond, as well as the first green sukuk in the country. Rwanda, Kenya, I talked about the support we provided to Econ. In Tanzania, we worked very closely with the NNB Bank to issue their first gender bond. And then in Mauritius, we have also supported their first green bond issuance. And I can also say very confidently that the pipeline is actually very, very strong as well. So there's a lot of opportunity, but it's a drop in the ocean. We are coming from a very low base. I think the opportunity is quite massive. Yeah, and this is basically it. So allow me, if you could, ladies and gentlemen, to end with a proverb. And this is it's a Native American proverb. It says that we do not inherit the earth from our ancestors. We borrow it from our children. Let me end with that, and I hope you can keep that in mind. We do not inherit the earth from our ancestors. We borrow it from our children. We borrow it from those children that we had speaking to us at the beginning of the presentation. Thank you very much.